Good morning, and welcome to Good Shepherd Barrhaven. We are here for Easter, the third Sunday of Easter, and I will begin with some community announcements. As you probably know, we're live streaming and recording to Facebook our morning prayer services Monday through Thursday. So you're welcome to join us at 8:30 or to check out the recordings anytime on our Facebook page. Our Easter Bible study continues this week, Wednesday, beginning at, I didn't write it down, 7 or 7:30, 7 p.m. I believe. And in the handout that you've been mailed is a website where you can have a look at the videos we'll be using in that Bible study, that we are using in that Bible study. Today, well, you know it's not an easy time right now. The number of vaccinations and COVID-19 cases and variants are rising. Long-term hopes may have been dashed this past week. It's a dark time, but as people of faith, as our communique this week from the Anglican Diocese said, take hope in the resurrection and trust in the new life of Christ that is with us no matter what. Speaking of hope and the future, this afternoon at 1 p.m., we're having our Zoom meeting town hall to talk about our next move. We have done the research. We have come to a come back to a suggestion, a great idea that we move this September, as we voted to move at our annual general meeting. We move out of 3500 Fowl Field and into the Barrhaven United Church. It's work that was started a long time ago, and we picked up again. We found in Barrhaven United Church almost all the things we've asked for, and come to that meeting. We sent out the Zoom invitation. I'm hearing we might need to send it out again. Sometimes it ends up in your junk email file or something like that, but I do hope to see all the members of Good Shepherd Barrhaven at the Zoom meeting at 1 o'clock. I'm also announcing for the second time a special vestry coming up next Sunday at 1 o'clock. We're having another Zoom meeting. The special vestry is a way we formally, as a community, approve the cemetery board's purchase of a columbarium. To build a columbarium with money bequeathed to the cemetery by Lois Long. It's being held at the diocese, and so we're going to withdraw that money and spend it on this project. Part of the formal getting that money out needs us to vote that we agree. I'm sure we all agree. Sandy's done a lot of good work. The committee with Paula and Shirley has prepared the history and the purchase order and everything. We'll send that out with the Zoom invitation so you can review it all and actually see the map of where the bench and the columbarium and the other bench are going to be out front at St. John Merivale Anglican Cemetery. So that's next Sunday afternoon. Special vestry needs two announcements, and this is the second one. So town hall tonight, or this afternoon at 1, special vestry next Sunday at 1. Our service will begin now for Sunday, the third Sunday of Easter, with a land acknowledgement. The earth is the Lord's and all its fullness, the world and those who dwell therein.
For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters.
O God, our Creator, we acknowledge the Algonquin peoples as the first stewards of this land.
Help all who call this land home to honor their legacy and to work for the peace of your kingdom.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Refreshed by the resurrection life we share in Christ, let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We thank you, risen Christ, for these waters where you make us new, leading us from death to life, from tears to joy. We bless you, risen Christ, that your spirit comes to us in the grace-filled waters of rebirth, like rains to our thirsting earth, like streams that revive our souls, like cups of cool water shared with strangers. Breathe your peace on our church when we hide in fear. Clothe us with mercy and forgive us. Send us companions on our journey as we share your life. Make us one, risen Christ. Cleanse our hearts. Shower us with life. To you be given all praise with the Holy Spirit in the glory of God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
And together we'll say, Christ our Passover. Alleluia. Christ our Passover has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with the old leaven, the leaven of malice and evil, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Alleluia. Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death that he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So also consider yourselves dead to sin and alive in Jesus Christ our Lord. Alleluia. Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. Alleluia. Let us pray. O God, your Son made himself known to the disciples in the breaking of bread. Open the eyes of our faith, that we may see him in his redeeming work, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
And Cliff will now share with us our first reading.
A reading from the book of Acts. When Peter saw it, he addressed the people. You Israelites, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us, as though by our own power or piety we had made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the Holy and Righteous One and asked to have a murderer.
And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God, so your sins may be wiped out. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the first letter of John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. Beloved, we are God's children. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when He is revealed, we will be like Him. For we will see Him as He is. And all who have this hope in Him purify themselves, just as He is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that He was revealed to take away sins, and in Him there is no sin. No one who abides in Him sins, No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. Everyone who commits sin is a child of the devil, for the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The Son of God was revealed for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. Those who have been born of God do not sin because God's seed abides in them. They cannot sin because they have been born of God. The children of God and the children of the devil are revealed in this way. All who do not do what is right are not from God, nor are those who do not love their brothers and sisters. For this is the message you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. We must not be like Cain, who was from the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own deeds were evil and his brother's righteous. Do not be astonished, brothers and sisters, that the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death to life because we love one another. Whoever does not love abides in death. All who hate a brother or sister are murderers, and you know that murderers do not have eternal life in them. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses help? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
While the disciples were talking, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. Well, in their joy, they were disbelieving and still wondering. He said to them, "Have you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are my witnesses of these things." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing to you, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Am I the only one who finds it a little bit funny that Jesus says a ghost doesn't have bones and flesh? It's a little bit funny. And then he eats in their presence. Well, I've been sharing with my youngest our favorite jokes, trying to bring a little laughter into our house because it's a hard time and, you know, good to aim for the positive. Well, this is a joke that I've told to several congregations over the years, and sometimes I laugh at my own jokes, and I know that's not the way you're supposed to tell a joke. It's not funny. So I'll try not to laugh at my own joke. But I hope you get a giggle out of this. Little Johnny is about 5 years old. He's standing in the kitchen while his mom is making dinner. And his mom asks him to please go into the pantry and get her a can of tomato soup. Johnny didn't like the pantry. It was dark in there, and he was scared of the pantry. So he he said to his mom, I don't want to go in. It's scary. I'm scared. So mom asked again, and he persisted, but he was scared. He did not like to go into the pantry. Finally, mom said, it's okay, Johnny. You don't need to be frightened. Wherever you are, wherever you go, Jesus is with you. Jesus will be with you, even in the pantry, even in the dark. Well, Johnny was not quite convinced, but sure this was what he needed to do. He walked toward the pantry and slowly opened the door, and he looked inside, and he saw that it was still dark, and he started to back up. When all at once he had a great idea, he reached out his hand into the dark and said, Jesus, if you're there, could you please hand me a can of tomato soup? All right, a little giggle. The disciples in the gospel reading from today, the words that the gospel uses are startled and terrified. They were in a state of fear. They didn't know Jesus was with them, and then he appeared in their midst, and he was with them. But they were still terrified because they knew that he had died. And they thought they were seeing a ghost. Now, in the Gospel of Luke, we know that two of them had already encountered the risen Jesus. Two of them had already walked and talked with him on the road to Emmaus. And the others had heard about this, had heard how Jesus had met them on the road and how he had been made known to them when they sat at the table in the breaking of bread. Now Jesus was there with them. Jesus stood there and said again, peace be with you. But even his presence there with them didn't at first bring them peace because they were terrified. So Jesus had to calm them down before they could listen. I'm thinking a lot about this, the way we can get frightened, we can get anxious, we can get scared of what's happening in our world. We can get angry. We can get upset. We can move into those emotions that hijack our ability to think, to listen, to pray. And I say that because I know that God is with us even in all of our emotions, all of our moods. But in times of terror, we need to calm down before we can make the next right step, before we can remember that we're beloved and that all is going to be okay. Jesus had to calm them down before they could listen, before they could learn. He showed them his hands and his feet. He asked them if they had something to eat. He was showing them, telling them that he wasn't a ghost. He wasn't a ghost. Which reminds me of another joke my daughter told me. Do you want to hear a joke about a ghost? Here. That's the spirit.
Oh.
Oh.
What a crap.
Oh, what a joker. Jesus is telling them he wasn't a ghost. And he was telling them by eating grilled fish with them. Ghosts don't eat leftovers. But then he could open their minds. Then he could open their minds to understand the scriptures, to understand that all of the scriptures, the Hebrew Old Testament, the law of Moses, the prophetic writings, the Psalms, the poetry, all of the scriptures was fulfilled in him. You may or may not be afraid of the dark. You may or may not get spooked by a creaky basement or a dark hallway. We always kept the light on. You know, those little night lights that you plug in? We always kept those in the hall at our house, not only because I was terrified of dark hallways when I was a child. We also once had a five-year-old a bit afraid of the dark. I was older than that when I was afraid to walk down the middle of the hallway in the middle of the night. But I'm pretty much over that.
you may or may not have been startled by seeing somebody you didn't expect to see. I know I've heard people talk about in their middle or later age catching sight of themselves in a mirror and wondering, whoa, who that person is. We've been startled. We all have startling moments. We all have fears that are even deeper than that. Fears of the unknowns. Fears of the unknown unknowns. One of the Society of St. John the Evangelist brothers, Brother Jonathan Morey, says, we all, human beings, have some fears built into our DNA that have helped to preserve us as a species, right? Some of the phobias that we have. He says, I believe that the true deepest fear that we have is that of losing the love and regard of those close to us, or of even God. I think he's got a point there. We worry. We worry about accidents and about people getting hurt, about disfigurement, about disease, people suffering. Everything in our world has changed, and there's been a lot of pain this past year plus. There's been death on a public scale in a way that many of us have never experienced before. And so we worry about our neighborhood, we worry about our families and our country and the world, and we try to use certain things to bring order into our lives, and some of that is helpful. We declutter, or we order more stuff online, or we spend money, or we save money. Some of that's not helpful. But anyway, none of it will stop chaos. Chaos happens. It helps if we don't fall into those places of terror. But listen to the peace that Jesus offers. Listen to the peace that Jesus leaves in this world. Hear it, know it. I am with you always, Jesus says. His word assures us. Beloved, you are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this. When he is revealed at the last time, we will be like him. We will see him as he is. We are assured that God's perfect love casts out fear. Casts out fear. Church has been called many things. One thing church is not is a self-improvement society where we work to get just a little better every day or week by week. We are an Easter people. We are the body of Christ. The church has the power of God working through us and in us, allowing us to serve one another. Not all and be worried at the same time. Maybe we can help each other move back to that place where we can make good choices. We need not fear because Jesus is with us and he has conquered sin and death, and he brings order out of chaos, light into our darkness. And like those very first disciples, we may be startled sometimes, but Jesus will calm us when we lay down our fears. Jesus will open our minds to understanding that he came to offer us repentance and forgiveness to us and to many, and that we are his witnesses. Whenever we gather, whenever two or three are gathered together, we don't just tell stories of events that happened a long time ago. We meet the risen Christ. We meet him here today. We meet him in his word proclaimed. Whenever you're hearing this, we meet him in the breaking open of the word, in these words. Sometimes we meet him in the bread and wine, blessed and broken. When we eat and drink with Jesus. There's a line in Inherit the Wind, the play in the movie about the Scopes Monkey Trial, when the defense lawyer Henry says about Matthew's Brady, the prosecutor. He says, a giant once lived in that body, but Matt Brady got lost because he was looking for God too high up and too far away. Too high up and too far away is not where we're going to look for God. No, Jesus is with us always. Here, out there, in your kitchen, in your truck. Encounter God, know God, listen and follow God by choosing to. God wants us to get Him, to know Him better and better. Gifts us with faith, and our faith is a response. We can know Jesus, we can know Christ, not fully as we are known, not yet, but we can get to know Him more and more. Through His Word, through the Bible. I was very excited yesterday to hear at the funeral of Prince Philip the reading from Ecclesiasticus from Sirach. I ran upstairs and I got my NRSV Bible and I looked up what page Sirach was on and I found it on page 800 and I flipped through to the chapter 23. What a gorgeous reading. What a gorgeous reading about God being present in the natural world. It was lovely. Our Bible will help us to learn God's presence, God's love for us, and not just hearing it read from this lectern on Sundays. I proclaimed when I was ordained, when I took my vows, that I do believe the Holy Scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be the Word of God and to contain all things necessary to salvation. I do believe, and I do believe we can hear His voice when we let Him in, when we get to know and trust Him. We can all pattern our lives according to Jesus' teaching. The Bible is a good book, and it's good to have a Bible you can read. And if the only Bible you have in your house is an old family Bible that's too heavy or fragile or falls apart, order one, a new one off Amazon, or ask me, and I can give you one. A Bible that you can read. That's the first step. Or maybe you read it on an app, because it's 2021. We may be like those first disciples, sitting around talking about how Jesus was raised from the dead, but when we remain in our fears, we don't get anywhere. When Jesus opens our hearts to see His truth, His beauty, His love, He frees us from our fears, and we can live in that new hope and joy. The better we get to know Him, the better we recognize His voice in this book, the Bible, the more fully that life-giving Word will transform us. What did it mean that the Messiah had to suffer and to be raised to life again? What did it mean that the message of repentance and forgiveness had to start in Jerusalem and spread to the whole world? We're about to affirm our faith in the words of an ancient creed that unites us with the body of Christ in every time and place. And we do this again and again to celebrate the resurrection of Christ so that we might be nourished to go out, not in fear, but in peace. Peace and love and service in Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, in the words of the Apostles' Creed, let us confess our faith, saying,
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Once again, a reminder, you're welcome to join in this prayer feed on Facebook each morning from Monday to Thursday for morning prayer. And members of the Good Shepherd Barrhaven community have been sent an invitation to a Zoom town hall meeting this afternoon at 1 o'clock, so please join us. Our service continues with a song.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord.
in our prayers of the people, let us keep in mind the discussion that we will be having this afternoon on our move. And I especially have a vested interest in our special vestry next week, and I ask for your prayers for that. And the board meeting that we'll be having later this month, let's pray also for Paula and all who lead ministries. In the Anglican Lutheran prayer cycle, we pray for the Most Reverend Anne Germana, Anglican Archbishop, and the clergy and people of the Diocese of Algoma, and the Lutheran Dean Council and congregations of the Manitoba South Area of the Manitoba Northwestern Ontario Synod. We pray for the right of Indigenous peoples to free, prior, and informed consent, and a renewed commitment to responsible resource extraction. In the Anglican Diocese weekly prayer cycle, we pray for our church, Good Shepherd Barrhaven, and the Reverend Margaret Whittaker. We pray for St. George's Clayton and the Reverend Patricia Black. In our companion Diocese of Jerusalem in the Middle East, we pray for the clergy and people of St. Peter's Church, Versailles, West Bank. In our Good Shepherd Church weekly prayer cycle, we pray for the worldwide persecuted church and for the boldness to share our faith. We pray for the protection and defense of the persecuted Christian church worldwide. We continue to pray for all of those in our parish. Today, we pray for Adrian, Rosemary, and Allison. Sandy, Birgit, and Jackie, we ask for their blessings by your word. We pray for those in need in our parish. Hope, Peter, Heather, Jennifer, Shannon, Tom, Kaylee, Suzanne, Owen, Ruth, Mary Lou, Jeff, Ron, and Lois, Dorothy, Mark, and Jane, Chrissy, and Christina, Jacob, Krista, Peter, and Michael, Norma R., Chantel, Connie, Henry, Sandra, Annette, Rosemary, Anita, Inez, Andrea, Robbie, Andrea K., Margaret, Elizabeth, Doreen Akers, Corrine, Valerie, Maxine, Manny and Natalie, Terry, Eric, Adriana, May and Tom, Brian and Judy, Angela and Trent, Jason Robertson. We pray today for the people of St. Vincent and all the people of Barbados and St. Lucia who are suffering the effects of a pretty mighty volcano. Also, let's take a minute for us to pray either silently or aloud for those who are in our hearts today. Pray that our risen Savior may fill us with the joy of his holy and life-giving resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That isolated and persecuted churches may find fresh strength in the Easter Gospel. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That he may grant us humility, be subject to one another in Christian love. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That he may provide for those who lack food, work, or shelter. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That by his power, wars and famine may cease through all the earth. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That he may reveal the light of his presence to the sick, the weak, and the dying, that they may be comforted and strengthened. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That he may send the fire of the Holy Spirit upon his people, that we may bear faithful witness to his resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
Amen. We continue with the Lord's Prayer, gathering our prayers into one. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.